a government that works for all of us, the children, the elderly, the working people of this country, and not just the 1%.
For too long, frankly, in our country, for too long, we have not had these honest discussions about race. We've just not.
There are a number of great candidates. No, there really are. And I always like to jokingly say, may the best woman win.
Today in the red state of Texas, the South by Southwest Festival isn't just attracting some of the biggest names in tech, film, and music. It's also giving Democratic presidential candidates the chance to get up close and personal with potential voters. And that's where we find CNN's Leila Santiago. Leila, Beto O'Rourke isn't announcing just yet whether he's running for president, but he is there, and he is taking attendees behind the scenes on his recent Senate campaign. Tell us more.
Right. We had a chance to actually watch a very documentary with a lot of access to that run for the Senate, in which he went up against Ted Cruz, raised $80 million, lost narrowly by just 3 points. But more importantly, for a lot of the people in this audience that was here in this theater and in those outside of the theater, he took a question from an audience member who said, what's the deal? Right. Are you going to run in 2020? And he sort of deflected. He didn't give a straight answer. Instead, he decided to highlight other candidates that are currently looking at a big run in local elections. So he didn't quite answer that, even though he was here with his wife, Amy, as well as his daughter. And interesting timing here, because this morning, his campaign actually sent out, his staffers sent out an email telling folks, his supporters, to sign up for the announcement, to make sure that they are first on the list, first to know when he announces. Our sources are telling us that it is a matter of any day now. Remember, last week he said he made a decision about his future political career and that he would be announcing it soon. I caught up to him to find out when soon was, and he was pretty tight-lipped. He's really not giving much information on when that will be. That said, all of his supporters are watching every single move. He's been pretty quiet on social media, so not much there where he typically engages with his supporters. But people are just sort of waiting to see when will he speak next, and more importantly for them, what will he say?
Right,
about
and he sure
2020?
Is building the suspense for his supporters. I'm assuming that that's for a reason that they're going to like. Otherwise, why would he do that? Leila, let me ask you about Elizabeth Warren, who's set to speak at any moment now. Why is this particular event such a draw for Democrats?
Right, so this is South by Southwest, and I got to tell you, this is my first time attending. Yesterday, as I was walking around, I saw a lot of folks with Beto shirts, a lot of young people, a lot of engaged people, and so that's an audience that really, really is getting attention from the Democrats, especially Beto O'Rourke, and then you're seeing other candidates here that are speaking. We expect many of those to be at the town hall for CNN tomorrow as well. But you got to think about who is attending here. And those are young, engaged people. And that can be gold for some of these candidates that are looking to differentiate themselves among a very, very crowded field.
All right, Leila Santiago, there at South by Southwest in Austin, Texas. Thank you for your reporting. Turning now from the 2020 Democratic race to the current occupant of the White House, President Trump. When special counsel Robert Mueller submits his report, which we expect to come soon, there's a chance Congress or even the general public won't fully see what's in it. So I want to show you how Axios has laid this out this week, showing the forest through the trees for us, noting the past couple of years have been overwhelmed with political scandal, perhaps the most in American history. There's the hush money payments right before Trump won the election, with two women alleging affairs with Trump and the lies around those hush money payments. There is a historical parallel for this one. Bill Clinton denied having sexual relations with White House intern Monica Lewinsky. He did so under oath. He was impeached on grounds of perjury and obstruction of justice. Then there's the firing of FBI Director James Comey. We know it was at least in part because of the, quote, Russia thing. There's a parallel here, too. President Richard Nixon's Saturday night massacre in October of 1973 when he sought to purge high-level Justice Department officials investigating Watergate. And I want you to think about this one. negotiating the Trump Tower Moscow project during the campaign. And apparently we've learned hiding that from the public. No historical parallel there. And then there's Trump campaign staffers communicating with Russians, not once, not twice, more than 100 contacts made between Russians and Trump associates during the campaign. Again, zero precedent. Listen to what former Clinton press secretary Joe Lockhart had to say right here on CNN as the man who led the independent counsel investigation of Clinton, Ken Starr, listened.
President Clinton didn't go out every day and call this a witch hunt and say that there was nothing to this. President went about doing his job. President Clinton didn't 10,000 times tell lies and mislead the American public. He did mislead the American public and lie to them in that Roosevelt room. There's no defense of that. But to try to compare these things, and I think that's getting back to the Axios stories, that's the strength of the Axios stories. Donald Trump is using the full weight of the federal government and the executive branch now to protect himself and to cover up what he's done.
I want to bring in constitutional law expert Lawrence Tribe, who is involved in a number of lawsuits against the current president involving emoluments and Trump's national emergency declaration. He is also the author of the book, To End a Presidency, The Power of Impeachment. Professor Tribe, thanks for being here. Good to see you.
Good to see you, Anna.
You've been very critical of President Trump, and we just laid out how unprecedented some of this is, and yet you say now is not the time for impeachment. What is the threshold for impeachment in your mind?
Well, the threshold has certainly been met in terms of the likely offenses that are emerging from the evidence. But there's no point in impeaching a president when the Senate is really very much in his hip pocket and will not remove him. We really need to investigate thoroughly so much of what we know. We only know in dribs and drabs. A great deal has been amassed by Robert Mueller. Much of it will become public, not all of it. Much is being learned in the Southern District of New York, but it's mostly the House of Representatives, its investigations in the Judiciary Committee, the Oversight Committee, the Intelligence Committee. That's going to reveal a great deal. And then we'll see. We'll see whether the time has come to pull the impeachment trigger.
Do you worry that Democrats could overreach? Because we learned just this week, 80 people, businesses, connections to the president, people involved in, again, not just his business, but his inauguration, his campaign, his administration have been issued requests for documents, for communications. Mm-hmm. Is there risk in what the Democrats are going, the kind of scattershot way that they've started their investigations?
Honestly, it's not scattershot, Anna. It's very deliberate and careful. There's a lot of pent-up curiosity based not on just speculation, but on indictments that have been handed down by Robert Mueller, on investigations that are going on in the Southern District. And because prior to last November, the House of Representatives was in Republican control, and they weren't investigating anything in a meaningful way. A lot of pent-up information that needs now to be released and made public. Now, obviously, the Republicans are going to make it look like this is way too much. But all of these investigations are in response to completely unprecedented things this president has done, both in becoming president and in at least apparently obstructing justice during his presidency. So we're simply catching up to the truth.
You don't think impeachment is the answer yet, but you have said recently you don't believe President Trump will complete his first term in office. So do you think impeachment is coming, or how do you see this playing out?
Well, I don't have a crystal ball, but it seems to me very hard to believe that someone who would never have been elected in the first place if the public had known all of what he was doing behind the scenes, both with Russia and with Michael Cohen and with various people who were conspiring to hide the truth from the American people about the way he was violating the campaign finance laws, I think it's hard to believe that someone who would never have been elected is going to serve out his term. How it's going to end, I'm not sure. He may resign in order to avoid further embroilment and further damage to his entire empire. I don't think he'd resign without arranging to be pardoned by Vice President Pence. But whenever he resigns or is voted out of office or is impeached and removed, he's going to face prosecution by state authorities as well as federal authorities. So it's not going to be a pretty scene, but I think it's going to end sooner rather than later.
You mentioned earlier apparent obstruction of justice, a crime. I want you to hear this from Ken Starr, who served as special counsel for the Whitewater investigation, talking about a president being indicted.
Do you think a sitting president can be indicted?
Yes, and I disagree with the Justice Department's guidelines, but it is the historic position of the department that goes back to the days of Bob Bork and the Nixon administration. No person is above the law means that a president can be indicted, but that's not the Justice Department policy, and Bob Mueller, as you know, is an officer of the Justice Department and is therefore required to follow that policy. He cannot indict.
So Starr sort of saying it both ways. His argument the president can be indicted, but Mueller probably won't do it. Do you agree?
Well, I certainly agree that a president can be indicted. The Office of Legal Counsel policy to the contrary in 1973 was almost immediately reversed in a brief that the Department of Justice filed in the Supreme Court. The basic principle that we shouldn't lose sight of is that no one is above the law. And it is simply not the case under our Constitution that the only way to hold a president to account is through the political process of impeachment, important though it is, because a sitting president could really have Congress really in his hip pocket, as I suggested earlier. If a president were to have, for example, bribed just enough members of the Senate to be acquitted, it can't be that he simply serves out his term as though nothing happened. When a president commits serious offenses, some of them crimes, others involving violations of the Constitution that are extreme abuses of power, though they may not be criminal, like accepting emoluments and benefits from Saudi Arabia and Turkey and Russia, then that president has to be held to account.
Before I let you go, I have to ask you about the Supreme Court. Democrats are throwing out an idea that adding more justices might be the way to go if a Democrat is elected president. We heard this from former AG Eric Holder this week, also 2020 candidate Pete Buttigieg, who said he supports increasing the number of Supreme Court justices to as many as 15. What's your idea? Good or is this good or bad?
I think court packing is a bad idea. I can easily see the temptation to do it, but I think that it leads to a never-ending spiral of tit for tat. I think that we need to live with the judiciary as an independent body and not as a body that keeps getting either expanded or contracted accordion-like. I think that's not the way to go. I do think that in the long run, the American people will hold the president accountable, and in the long run, we will have a Supreme Court that is much more independent than I think even this president wants it to be. The court is not likely, any more than the court in the Nixon era did his bidding just because he had appointed some of its members. I think this court wants to go down in history as an independent branch, and the Chief Justice, whom I had the privilege of teaching when he was my con law student, I think the Chief Justice is going
John
to
Roberts.
Do his part. John Roberts is going to do his part to prevent the court from becoming just an appendage of the executive.
Lawrence Tribe, thank you so much for being here.
Thank you, Anna.
Fresh doubt over the progress made between President Trump and Kim Jong-un. New satellite images reveal a rocket or missile could be close to having another launch. And later, the report have shed light on the political strategies that may define who wins the White House in 2020. It's really up to the eye of the beholder and the voter. On one side, Trump's detractors see an administration beset by constant corruption, the sheer number of investigations surrounding the president and his orbit, is getting daunting. So much so, the New York Times and Washington Post have published guides to help you keep up. There are now 10 different House committees looking into Donald Trump's administration, several spurred by his former lawyer, Michael Cohen's testimony. And they're not solely focusing on protecting the special counsel and his Russia investigation. Democrats in full control of the House have taken a different route, making good on promises to bombard the president with investigations. But President Trump is not playing defense, even as his former campaign manager is in prison, to be followed soon by his former lawyer. Instead, the president is making clear that Americans were promised collusion and citing both the Manafort sentencing and Cohen testimony as proof he has been right all along. Take a look at this tweet. Both the judge and the lawyer in the Paul Manafort case stated loudly and for the world to hear that there was no collusion with Russia. Okay. Facts first. To be clear, that is not what the judge said. Judge Ellis merely noted that Manafort wasn't accused of collusion and that his trial was focused on unrelated financial crimes. But again, focusing on the politics here, it's clear the president is framing a message to voters. Pair that with Trump's reaction to Cohen's testimony.
He lied a lot, but it was very interesting because he didn't lie about one thing. He said, no collusion with the Russian hoax. And I said, I wonder why he didn't just lie about that, too, like he did about everything else.
Ken Cuccinelli is the former Virginia attorney general and a CNN legal and political commentator. And Julian Zelizer is a historian and professor at Princeton University and a CNN political analyst. Ken, Trump has never been beholden to the facts, but he has been remarkably successful at selling a message. Is that what the president's counting on with these investigations?
Well, in part, I mean, you make lemonade out of lemons, right? I mean, Congressman Doug Collins' letter this past week to Jerry Nadler, the new chairman of the Judiciary Committee, has not gotten a lot of coverage. But if you look at it and if you read it all the way through, it is devastating. It is absolutely devastating from both a political and a legal standpoint. I started this.
Devastating
as
to who?
A lawyer,
to the president?
To Nadler. I mean, it. One of the things you commented about the promises the Democrats made to bombard the White House, and you're absolutely right. That is exactly what they promised. The problem is, while there is a minority of Americans who really love that and cheer it on, that is not where most Americans are. Most Americans want to see people taking an objective view of even the questions that arise between the Democrats and the president. And that's not what's happening here. That's why Doug Collins' letter to this one chairman, a very important one on judiciary, is going to be so important because I think the Democrats in Congress are overdoing it. And the president, as you noted, his habit is not to play defense. He's using that to go on offense. But what other choice does he have? He can either do that or get pummeled by all these committee chairmen.
Okay, let me pick up on what you said about the Democrats. And are they doing these investigations to the detriment of themselves? Julian, you have a piece on CNN.com that kind of explores this, the search for a smoking gun and the possibility they may not find a smoking gun. Are they dancing with danger, politically speaking, here?
Sure. With investigation, there's always the risk that you stimulate a backlash or that you do it the wrong way. And it undermines the investigation itself. I don't think that's what's happening now. They are actually conducting oversight that has not really been done in the first 2 years. And they're looking at questions that many of people, not just the base of the Democratic Party, agree need to be looked at. Part of it's about the campaign. Part of it's about conflict of interest between the business empire of the president and the presidency. And then other issues such as obstruction of justice. It might be there's no smoking gun. There's no tape that has President Trump saying, I did X, Y, and Z. But there's a mountain of evidence already that there are problems and questions about whether this White House has been accountable.
There are some interesting poll numbers this week, Ken. According to a Quinnipiac University poll, 64% of registered voters said Trump had committed crimes before entering office. That's what they believe. Nearly half of voters, 45%, think he's committed crimes while serving as president. And yet, a Monmouth poll revealed the president's job approval rating among Republicans stands at 86%. So if Republicans think Trump committed crimes, do they just not care about that?
Well, I think a lot of this, from a, just to give the Republican perspective, a lot of the rigmarole here that has been more intense for this president is viewed through the filter of the last president, a president who said, you know, Congress, do what I want you to do, or I've got a phone and I've got a pen and I'll do it myself. And then when you see the coverage of this president's version where people say, oh, he broke the law, he did the, like, take the National Emergency Declaration. This isn't even a constitutional issue. It's a statutory one. And the president is using power Congress gave to the presidency.
Although there are Republicans who would argue that it's not a constitutional issue.
No, it's not a constitutional issue. And I mean, I talked, for instance, to Senator Paul's office. Senator Rand Paul is extremely principled on these sorts of questions, and they don't argue that it's a constitutional issue. They are, as I understand it, they argue that this is a more power than the presidency should have, and so Senator Paul will not support its exercise, and that they also dispute, I presume, the use of dollars being beyond the scope of the statute. But they, none of them, as far as I know, on the Republican side, make any suggestion that this is a constitutional issue.
There are Republicans that we've heard from who do make an objection on the constitutional basis. Marco Rubio is one of them.
What constitutional basis?
Julian, back to the investigations that we were talking about. I remember back in December where Democrats were saying their top priority, if they are, you know, once they took office in January, was going to be getting the president's tax returns. That hasn't happened. They haven't even requested them yet.
Right. The Ways and Means Committee, it looks like, is moving in that direction. They don't have it yet, and the president is certainly going to invoke his own power as president to stop that. He's been very resolute. But I think many Democrats feel that could open some keys to questions that have been raised. The president, it's unclear that he has to do this. It's been a tradition for candidates to give over the material. Now he's president. So he actually might be in more of a fix. But I think the Democrats will keep up that pressure. There's so many fronts right now that they are looking into. I think they are trying to prioritize, and I think they're trying to figure out what is the most urgent areas to look into. And the reason that a lot of Republicans think the way you do, back to your original question, that's partisanship. I think there's a big disconnect between how Republicans feel about supporting a Republican president, and the striking part of that poll, what they think of the president they're supporting. And it's been hard for Democrats to change that dynamic.
Julian Zelizer, Ken Cuccinelli, I appreciate both of you. Thanks so much for being here.
Thank you.
A new blow to U.S.-North Korea relations, satellite images revealing. This weekend, again, the people of Venezuela are boiling over with anger. This is in Caracas, but Venezuelans are furious all over the country. Supporters of embattled President Nicolas Maduro and riot police physically clashing with people who believe in opposition leader Juan Guaido as the legitimate president. Also, right now, nearly all of the country is without electricity. Since Thursday, many people blame the Maduro government for being incompetent and for corruption. Now, Venezuelan officials are telling the public that it was the U.S. and a sabotage that caused the blackout. People are getting very worried now, though, about food safety and hospital patients if the power doesn't come back on soon. Also overseas today, new concerns. North Korea is getting ready to launch something, either a missile or a rocket. People who keep an eye on North Korea say a lot of activity in one certain place is a dead giveaway. CNN's Will Ripley is in Beijing. Will.
What we're seeing right now, based on analysis of commercial satellite imagery, is a potentially troubling shift inside North Korea, a shift to a more defiant, perhaps militaristic posture after that failed summit in Hanoi with North Korean leader Kim Jong-un and U.S. President Donald Trump. New satellite images of a rocket and missile factory near the North Korean capital, Pyongyang, a place known as Sanumdong, indicate, according to two analysts I've spoken with, that North Korea has assembled something, maybe a space rocket, maybe an intercontinental ballistic missile. But whatever they've assembled, they have put on a rail car, and the train has now left the station. Where it's headed? We just don't know. But we do know that North Korea is one of their main launch sites, the Sohae Satellite Launch Facility, which has been rebuilt after being partially dismantled as part of a pledge by Kim Jong-un to take the place apart. Well, now it's now believed to be back up and running, fully operational, according to private analysts, although that has yet to be confirmed by the U.S. government. And if the Sohae launch station is ready to receive a rocket, and if satellite images show that a rocket has been placed on the launch pad, that will be a very clear message of defiance by Kim Jong-un in the wake of what sources describe as a humiliation in Hanoi, with President Trump leaving the North Korean leader bewildered after the North Koreans felt they made a good offer, only to have the U.S. delegation reject the offer and walk out, leaving them without a deal and without the sanctions relief that they really so desperately need inside that country. What could this mean for diplomacy? Well, it really depends on how the United States responds. North Korea has always claimed that space rockets are, you know, putting satellites into orbit for scientific research. But of course, those space rockets use the same kind of technology that missiles use, technology that's banned by the United Nations Security Council. All of this happening, as sources tell CNN, Chinese President Xi Jinping is also having second thoughts about his own planned trip to the United States for trade talks with President Trump later this month. The Chinese saying that they don't want President Trump to walk out on Xi like he walked out on Kim, an indication that Trump's credibility in terms of diplomacy has really been undermined in the wake of that walkout and that failed summit in Hanoi. Will Ripley, CNN, Beijing.
Thanks, Will. Caught on camera, the moment a car loses control and almost crashes into the presidential motorcade. This is in Alabama. We'll show you the moment of impact next. Alabama yesterday.
Oh, my God, right at the president. Are you kidding me? Are you kidding me? Did y'all see that?
Yeah, I got it on footage.
Holy smoke. There went the President of the United States, and that car almost took him out.
Well, those wires
We got all that on video.
Holy smokes. That video was captured by a bystander just standing along the freeway. Apparently, the motorcade did not stop or slow down during that incident. The Alabama Highway Patrol says the police department is investigating the accident. We're learning new details about the woman seen here in this selfie with President Trump during a Super Bowl watch party this year. She is the former owner of the spa where Patriots owner Robert Kraft is accused of soliciting prostitution, something he denies. CNN and the Miami Herald uncover new details of her connection with prominent members of the Republican Party. CNN's Kaylee Hartung joins us now live from Jupiter, Florida. What are you learning about this former owner, Kaylee?
Well, Anna, it's not unusual for the president or any high-profile lawmaker to take a photo with a political donor. Of course, President Trump has done so more times than he could count, certainly with more people than he could name. But the optics of this photo are raising some big questions.
Her name is Li Yang. She goes by Cindy. She's been spotted with the who's who of the GOP, including the president's sons at Mar-a-Lago, Kellyanne Conway at the inauguration, and Sarah Palin. But it's this selfie Yang took with President Trump at a Super Bowl watch party that's raising eyebrows. Yang is the former owner of the Orchids of Asia Day Spa, the massage parlor where Florida authorities say they caught New England's Patriots owner and Trump friend, Robert Kraft, on camera paying for oral sex.
He's being charged with the same offenses as the others, and that is soliciting another to commit prostitution.
Kraft denies any wrongdoing. According to the Miami Herald, Yang no longer owns Orchids of Asia, the publication reporting she sold it back in 2013. CNN repeatedly tried, but was unable to reach Yang for comment. She did speak with the Miami Herald.
But she didn't answer the question of whether she knew that there was sex happening. She simply told us that she's no longer in the spa business, she doesn't know President Trump, and she's planning to move to Washington, D.C.
It should be noted, Yang was not charged in the anti-human trafficking bust that led to misdemeanor charges against Kraft and the closing of several spas in South Florida. The White House declined to comment on Yang, but President Trump did speak about the charges against Kraft.
Well, it's very sad. I was very surprised to see it. He's proclaimed his innocence totally, but I'm very surprised to see it.
Yang donated upwards of $35,000 to the Trump campaign, according to FEC filings. She's a self-made entrepreneur who, according to the Miami Herald, showed little political interest before the 2016 election, in that she had not voted in the 10 years prior.
We're learning more about Lee or Cindy Yang's recent political support for President Trump. In 2017, Anna, she donated $37,000 to his campaign fund. In 2018, another $37,000. And that same year, the man reported to be her husband donated more than $10,000. Again, Yang has not been accused of any wrongdoing, but we go back to the optics of this photo.
Eyes at parks, on sidewalks, and increasingly at schools. An elite private school in the nation's capital is carrying out an investigation after some students displayed swastikas during a school assembly just this past week. And on the West Coast, images of high school students at a party doing a Nazi salute over a swastika made of beer cups widely shared on social media. Our Sarah Seidner takes a closer look at the growing displays of hate in America's schools. And it is disturbing. Sarah.
Yeah, experts are telling us that they are seeing a disturbing trend among America's youth, their attraction to Nazi and racist symbolism. But you're going to meet one woman who survived the death camps, who says she's trying to solve the problem and steer them away from hate, one community at a time. High school students in Alabama spouting violent, racist, and anti-Semitic comments and enjoying every minute of it. Then posting it on social media.
Not the Holocaust? What would the world be like?
We would have white people now. All of the numbers would not
Jews,
be
there. Jews would run the world.
Jews are fine.
If the Holocaust never happened, Jews would be running the world right
it's
now.
It's fine. We just need Think about that.
What are you going to do with them? Awesome. You stick them in concentration.
You have to wait till they die.
Oh. The girl you hear repeatedly saying the N-word sent out a statement on her father's car dealership Facebook page. The horrible, horrible things I said were a terrible attempt to be funny. I'm sorry to anyone that had to listen to the video. I will do everything in my power to be better each and every day. But this is just one example of a rising tide of hate among youth. The same week, thousands of miles away in upscale Newport Beach, California, high school students do a Nazi salute above a red cup swastika they created. Parties with a side of Nazi rhetoric seem to be popular with some teenagers these days.
What I saw was how the combination of ignorance, evil, shock, and peer validation can come together at a time when the social political landscape is about othering and polarization. And what happens is there's a race to the bottom because we don't have civic moral leadership in this country that sets a standard as to what's acceptable communally.
Brian Levin is a professor at Cal State San Bernardino and runs the Center for the Study of Hate and Extremism. He and other experts on the subject say there has been heavy recruiting by white nationalist groups in recent years on college campuses and grade schools. The Anti-Defamation League found in 2017, anti-Semitic incidents in K-12 schools increased by an astounding 94% after nearly doubling the year prior. And the FBI says between 2016 and 2017, reports of hate crimes against Jews skyrocketed, up 37%. Overall hate crimes reported, up 17%. While several white nationalists, KKK, and neo-Nazi groups are trying to disguise their hateful messages to make it more attractive to the mainstream, Levin says the youth are looking for shock and awe that's popular on social media. The behavior isn't just appearing at parties. Last month in New York, it appeared on a playground. And a new Nazi way to ask for a date to a dance in Minnetonka, Minnesota. She later apologized. Eva Schloss hopes she's an antidote to anti-Semitism among the youth. She is a Holocaust survivor, the stepsister of Anne Frank, whose story of surviving the Holocaust has haunted and inspired the world for more than 70 years. Schloss traveled to a Newport Beach high school just days after some of its students took part in the incident. She sat down privately with the offending students and their parents.
I just told them that the Nazis did really horrible, horrible thing, not just gassing Jewish people, but even their own disabled people. That was the first experiment with gassing children or people.
Schloss survived Auschwitz concentration camp at 16, but most of her family were annihilated by the Nazis, along with 6 million Jews. And now, more than 70 years after the attempt to exterminate so many human beings, she's faced with young people who think Nazi symbolism is all the rage.
How hurtful it was for many, many survivors of the Holocaust who have lost millions of their families all over the world, really, you know? I mean, it is an insult to those people.
Insult to you?
Yes, insult to me as well.
And lastly, are you afraid, now that you've seen young people doing this over and over and over again here in America, are you afraid for the next generations of people?
Well, there's so much education going on now, and it's going to be improved. It's going to be more and more. And I hope that eventually they will see the light that it is not any more acceptable. I'm still an optimist, you know? I think it can't go on that people do such evil acts. It must not happen, and it will not happen.
Eva Schloss did tell us that she was indeed shocked that in 2019, in a well-educated town with highly educated students, that incidents like this still occur. But when you speak to experts, they say that it will continue to occur across this country and abroad unless there is a strong push for education, not just by the school system, but by parents themselves and politicians as well. Back to you.
Sarah Seidner, thank you. So disturbing. Now, the descent on South by Southwest 2020 contenders take Austin by storm. What Beto O'Rourke just told a crowd there about a run for the White House. But first, we want to take a moment right now to honor this week's CNN hero. As a high school student, Zach Weigel teamed up with hospitals to help bring video games to sick kids across the country.
Suiting up!
Sometimes people believe that video games are corrupting the minds of America's youth. But video games are an incredible tool for helping kids find a source of fun and relief during really